lightweight rock cipher. Amazing. The first talk of this session is refraction quick analysis of brain slide ciphers. The authors are Hardy Solomony, Selin Blanda, Xiaoli Yu, Wenlin Wu, Kaisa Neighbor, Hui Ling Zhang, Lei Zhang, and Yanfeng Wang. I think this is a joint paper, so we get a long list of authors here. Hardy will be passed. Let's welcome Hardy.
Okay, hello everybody. I'm going to talk about reflection cryptanalysis of things like cipher. So this is the outline of the presentation. First, I will describe the things like ciphers. Then I will introduce new distinguishers for this kind of ciphers. And after that, I explain how to apply Q recovery and also various classes of alpha reflection. And finally, I conclude. So, the PRINCE is a low latency block cipher. It was proposed at last Asia Peak. It's a fixed construction. The master key is divided into two parts. The first part is used as a whitening key in the beginning and at the end. And also K1 is used as in the core of the cipher. So the last whitening key, K0 prime, is also obtained by K0 simply in this way. And also the cipher has an interesting property which is called alpha reflection. It means that instead of using decryption algorithm, we can use encryption algorithm by just swapping the whitening keys, K prime 0 and K0. And also use K1 XOR to alpha instead of K1. And independently of the value of alpha, designers show that the PRINCE is secure against known attacks, standard attacks like differential linear attack. And our goal in this work is to study the effect of value alpha on the security of the PRINCE like cipher structure. So, at the first, before describing the cipher, because there is another paper about PRINCE, the next talk, I should state that our description is a bit different from the original description. So, don't be confused about this. Anyway, in the middle of the cipher, there is a linear, there is an involution linear layer, M prime, and also a nonlinear layer S and inverse of S. Also, there are five more rounds at the beginning and also five more rounds at the end. And each round in the beginning is consists of K1 adding key, adding ground constant, and the nonlinear layer S, and another linear, the second linear layer, which is called M. M can be obtained from M prime simply, as we will describe. And actually, in the last round, each round is consists of similar elements, but in inverse. It means first we have inverse of M, inverse S, adding round constant, adding key. And so it's it's the core of the cipher, and as I mentioned before, so also for having alpha reflection property, the constants should have this property which holds in this equation. And also, as I mentioned before, it's, there are two more whitening keys at the beginning and at the end. So the original piece has the length of the block is 64. And the specific value of alpha is chosen this value. And the S layer, the nonlinear layer, is a nibble wise. Each nibble is preceded by the same spot. And also, M prime, the first linear layer, is an emulation matrix, 64 times 64 bits, and it's diagonal, and it can be constructed by two smaller matrices, M0 hat and M1 hat, where M0 hat and M1 hat are also constructed by four smaller matrices, M0, M1, M2, and M3. And finally, the second linear matrix M in the prints, in the original prints, can be obtained by composition of M prime and also a simple permutation SR, which behaves like a shift row in the AES. Now, first, let's look at the previous works. Reflection attack is a type, is a kind of type of attack, and it has been applied on some primitives in black ciphers and hash functions with faster structure. The idea is that if in the middle of the cipher, if the left part of the state and is equal to the right one, then also assume that the subkeys are equal, then without knowing the key, since the input of the functions are equal and also the functions are equal, then without knowing the key, we know that the output of the function are equal. So if you look at the two rounds of the cipher in the middle, then we know that the probability, at the same probability, the input and output are equal. So the difference between input and output is zero. And so in this, and of course, if for more rounds, if symmetrically the subkeys are equal, then we can extend the distinguisher for more rounds of the cipher. So in this work, we're using probabilistic reflection. It means we use probabilistic scenario to extend our distinguishers, because in the prints, in the print cipher, we have round constants which are related to each other, but they are not equal. So we can't use deterministic reflection distinguisher. And also, we try to do this for an SVM construction. To introduce the distinguisher, first we have this definition. For a function f from the set A to the same set, and a point x, an element x, is called fixed point if the output of the function is equal to the input. And it can be proved that if function f be linear involution, then the number of fixed points is at least 2 to the n over 2. And we use this fact. So the idea is to take the advantage, the fact that there are at least 2 to the n over 2 fixed points in the middle of the cipher, and also use the alpha reflection property and construct the reflection distinguisher. So let's look at the middle of the cipher. For the first, we introduce one distinguisher for two rounds of the middle of the cipher. With this probability, we have a fixed point here. The difference is zero, so we can pass the nonlinear layer with the same property. And finally, because of the relation between round constant, the difference between here and here is alpha with this probability. Similarly, we can introduce another distinguisher. So with this probability, we have a difference alpha from here to here. And so after the round constants, the difference is zero, so we can pass one round, and finally, the difference between input and output of the four rounds of the cipher in the middle of the cipher with this probability is alpha. Now, to extend, but still we are far from the whole of the cipher, so to extend the distinguisher, we should, and also in the case that there's another point, in the case that this probability is zero, there is still a kind of distinguisher. We have an impossible differential. It means that never it's happened. This happens in the, also for the original value of alpha in the prints. So to extend our distinguisher, assume that for two or four rounds of the middle of the cipher, the difference between here and here is alpha. Now if you look at the from inside to the input and inside to the output, the rounds function behave similarly to each other. There is only a difference here, and the round constants are different, but they are still relation between them, and the difference between them are alpha. So the idea is to look at this cipher and try to find, for a specific value of alpha, try to find a differential related key characteristics for more rounds, and extend still extend this distinguisher for more rounds. Now, how we can do key recovery based on these distinguishers? Assume that with high probability this happens. It means that the difference between here and here for 2r minus 2r rounds of the cipher are delta. So with the same probability, we can pass the linear layers. And as usual, the idea is to guess corresponding keys in the first round and the last round and check whether the distinguisher holds or not. But still, to speed up the key recovery, we can do more. There are two ideas. The first one is doing the key recovery nibble by nibble. So first, we guess the corresponding keys from here and also the last ones, and check whether for the specific nibble, the value delta SR holds or not. Also, in the case that delta SR in the specific nibble is zero, we can pass the nonlinear layer, and so the effect of K1. So K1 is cancelled, and so it's not necessary to know the value of K1 in this specific nibble. And so by this ideas, we can also still speed up the key recovery attack. Now, based on the distinguishers and key recovery, which I explained before, we try to classify the alpha value. It means that if we choose a specific alpha, how choosing alpha affects the security of the cipher. So to maximize, let's look at again to the external characteristics. To maximize the external bounds, the probability of the external distinguisher for the external bounds, we have two ideas. The first one is cancellation. And also for a specific alpha, we can use branch and bond to find the best related key differential for more rounds. First cancellation idea, assume that for two or four rounds of the cipher, the difference here is alpha. So with this probability, after inverse of M and inverse of S, still we have alpha. So since the difference between round constant is alpha, so after key addition and round constant addition, the difference is zero. So we can pass one more round, and so after the key addition, again we have alpha. So it's an iterative characteristics for four rounds of the cipher. But of course, it's still we can do more by cancellation idea, we have a iterative characteristics for four rounds. And this alpha, which we have found, are listed here, which we can attack the full run of the cipher, and also by branch and bound algorithm, a simple branch and bound algorithm for 12 runs of the cipher, we can, for a specific alpha, we can find how many rounds we can attack, and some example of the full round of the attack for the value of alpha is listed here. So the observation is that still, if you look at this table and this table, most of the alpha value are low Hamming weight. So here, for example, we have 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. And so the question is that would it be sufficient to choose the alpha value such that the, most of the nibbles are active? Is it is it sufficient or not? So for example, let's look at this alpha value. All of the nibbles are active, but the inverse of the alpha it has just 4 active nibbles. So for this kind of alpha, which the inverse of alpha has this format, where SR means non-active, SR means arbitrary value, then we can show for 6 rounds of the cipher, we have the same truncated distinguisher, such that with probability 2 to the minus 32, the difference between the 6 rounds is this value. And also there are 3 more classes, truncated characteristic, which are listed here. So totally for 2 to the 18 values of alpha, there exist 6 rounds truncated characteristics with 2 to the minus 32 probability. And so we can attack up to 8 rounds of the cipher by using 2 to the around 36 data complexity and also 2 to the 88 full encryption. And as a conclusion, so we introduced generic distinguisher for Prince-like ciphers. And we showed that the security of Prince-like ciphers depends strongly on the value of alpha. And also we identified classes which were for 4, 6, 8, and 10 rounds of the cipher, we can distinguish the Prince core from the random ideal deviation. And in the case of the weakest class, we can attack 12 rounds of the cipher. And but still, for the original value of alpha, the attack just worked for 6 rounds. So we can conclude that the alpha value, which has been chosen by the designer, is among the best one. And so we can conclude that this work can be considered as a new design criteria for selection, for choosing of the value of alpha for Prince-like cipher. Thank you very much.
Is there any question for Hadi? No, I have a question. So besides Prince, what ciphers did you consider?
So actually, we have tried to apply this on more SPN block cipher, which are evolution. And at least we couldn't apply this for the ciphers, but it works for all of the keys. Because maybe it works for some ciphers in the weak keys scenario. But because one of the points is that the round constant, you should find a good relation between round constant. Yeah? So you can, such that you can extend your characteristics for more rounds. And so if for the non-black suffrage, which at least we tried, it was just to get this class. But in future, we should still try.
Thank you. Any more questions? Yeah?
Can you please go to the security, to the attack complex?
Can you speak up?
Sorry. Can you please go to the attack complex? On Prince, there is this special security margin that you can multiply the data in the attack complex.
Yeah. Actually, our main idea is that still we are it's just we wanted to show that we can apply the key recovery. I mean, distinguisher can be converted to key recovery parts. But you are right; it's more than 127. But the point is that for specific alpha, we can distinguish more rounds. Of the core of the cipher, but still it's secure against linear attack, differential attacks, I mean other classical attacks, statistical attacks. So yeah, maybe for key recovery, it doesn't work well.
But if you consider only Prince core, then everything is okay.
Why?
Because first there is no clear security margin on the Prince core.
Yeah, but it's proved that it's secure against differential and linear, okay? There is an upper bound. Yeah.
The time complexity there that you write, is it going to be smaller if you consider on the Prince core? The time complexity right there. Is it going to be reduced if you consider on the Prince core?
Of course. Okay. Because then you don't need to. Because one of the problems here is that, the relation between K0 and K prime 0 is not a direct relation, you know? So if you know K0, it doesn't mean that you have K prime 0. Yeah?
Thank you. Any more questions? If no, let's thank Hadi again.